Chemical reactions can proceed in two directions. You should have learned this about this in 3A, but sometimes you don't. So we can look at this equation. A plus B is forming C and D, and these two arrows, one pointing left, one pointing right, tells us that this reaction can go in two different directions. And we use something called an equilibrium constant, which is KEQ, to tell us the direction. Is it going mostly forward? Is it going mostly backwards? KEQ, what color am I on here? Let's just use this. KEQ is going to be equal to the concentration of the products, which are C and D, raised to a power that's equal to their coefficient. And we're not going to do much with this, but I really can't explain the next couple parts without just at least telling you what this thing is. So it's the concentrations of the product. If this had a coefficient of 2, then it would be the concentration of C squared times the concentration of D raised to a power equal to its coefficient, divided by the concentrations of the reactants. So if KEQ is larger than 1, that tells us that there is more product than reactant and that the forward direction of the reaction is favored. If KEQ is less than 1, that means that the denominator is larger and that there's going to be more reactant than product and the reverse reaction is favored. Well, why does a reaction go in one direction or the other? It has to do with energy. We'll get a reaction when the products are lower in energy than the reactants. And remember that lower in energy is more stable. So if the products are more stable, the reaction will go toward the products. If the reactants are more stable, the reaction will go towards the reactants. What happens when we move toward a lower energy product is that heat is given off, and we say that the reaction is exothermic. Exo meaning exiting, thermic energy. So energy is leaving. And we use these diagrams to illustrate this. So here we've got ethene plus HBr. It's in equilibrium with bromoethane. Well, ethene and hydrogen bromide have a higher energy than the product does. The product is more stable. On these graphs, you can think about how this would look in terms of gravity and potential energy. Something at a higher level above the ground is more unstable and has more energy than something that is lower. You know, if we have a piano that's 5 inches off the ground or a piano that's 50 feet off the ground, like in the cartoons where it's dangling out of the second story window, you know, which one's more dangerous to be under? The piano that's higher, right? So in these diagrams, higher vertically on the diagram means higher energy. So here the reactants are higher energy, the products are lower energy. If you cut the rope on that hanging piano, is it going to fall down or is it going to fly up? It falls down every time, doesn't it? It always wants to go to lower energy. Where does that energy go? It comes out. It gets released. So this is an exothermic reaction. Exothermic reactions tend to be spontaneous. They happen on their own. There's this letter here and this funny word, enthalpy. Enthalpy is a fancy term for heat energy, and we're really not going to discuss it much. We talk a little bit more about that in Chem 1A. Enthalpy, H, you can just think of it as heat for the purposes of this class. So this is an exothermic reaction. The change in H is negative because here the reaction had more H and here it has less H. And so it's losing H. I think of energy as being a lot like money. When you lose money, when it goes out of your wallet, do you feel positive or negative about that? Negative. And if money finds its way into your wallet, then you feel positive about that, right? So here is a reaction occurring where the reaction itself is losing energy. Energy's going out. And that's happening because the products are lower in energy than the reactants. The energy is conserved. The energy, energy content of the universe is constant. So we can't have energy just appearing and disappearing. It has to go somewhere. Here we have the opposite situation where the reactant is lower in energy than the product. And so this is going uphill against what nature wants. We have to put energy into this reaction. Falling down the hill is natural. You don't have to pay someone to do that. But to push something up the hill is against gravity. You have to expend energy. You have to put energy into that to make it happen. So here we have delta H being positive. This would have an equilibrium constant that is less than 1 because the reactants are going to be favored. This is an equilibrium constant that favors the products. And we had to talk about that so that we can talk about reaction rates. The equilibrium constant tells us where the equilibrium lies, if there's more reactant or more product, but it doesn't tell us how fast the reaction is. And reaction rates are important because there are some reactions that occur, but they occur so slowly that it just really doesn't matter. So we have to think about, well, what needs to happen in order for a reaction to occur? Well, the molecules have to collide with each other, and they have to bump into each other with enough energy that bonds are broken, and it has to be at the right orientation. This is a little bit like, you know, two people meeting and actually having sparks fly and falling in love and ending up spending the rest of their lives together, right? If they just kind of casually run into each other, but they don't even notice the other person, maybe they just passed on the sidewalk, nothing's going to happen. There's not enough energy there. If they never actually get into the same state, if they never actually meet, nothing's going to happen either. And then the orientation has to be correct. They have to be in the proper frame of mind to be receptive to meeting and liking a new person. So molecules are a lot like people. The energy that's required for this reaction is a barrier. And the higher the barrier, the slower the reaction. And so we draw reaction energy diagrams that show the changes in energy that occur during each step of a reaction. So here is an addition reaction. So here we've got our reactants, and this is ethene, and this is hydrogen bromide, and they're going to react and form this carbocation intermediate. But there's actually a transition state in which the hydrogen bromide is approaching this molecule. And this is higher in energy, and then when this electrophile attacks and forms the bond, it actually goes down a little bit in energy. And then there's another transition state where the bromide ion approaches this cation, and then that's kind of a hump. We have to get that to happen, and then once we get that, it's all downhill from there, and this bond forms and the reaction is done. So the difference here is a barrier to the reaction occurring. We have to get up and over the hump. It's a lot like miniature golf. Miniature golf, they have those little annoying humps and bumps and stuff, and you have to hit the ball hard enough to get it up and over, but not too hard that it goes flying, right? So you got to hit the ball. There has to be enough energy to get up and over the hump. Once you get over the hump, it'll roll down by itself. That's fine. But then there's another hump here that we have to get up and over, and once we get over that, we're fine. But usually if you hit the ball hard enough that it gets up here, it's going to roll down here and have enough energy to go up and over. And so this first hump here is what's going to limit how fast the reaction can go. This is going to be slow because the energy barrier here is very large, this EA1. is the activation energy or the energy barrier to this first step. The second one is much smaller. If we've got enough energy to clear the first one, we'll clear the second one and we'll be fine. And so here, this energy is limiting the rate of the reaction. So we see these transition states, this guy and that guy. Transition states are structures with maximum energy. You could say that they're theoretical because you can't isolate them. But it's a transitional state between two different things. And what we call the activation energy, E sub A for activation energy, is the difference in energy between the transition state and the reactant. If the activation energy is large, you're going to have a slow reaction. If the activation energy is small, we have a rapid reaction. And if there's more than one step, like we saw in that diagram, the overall reaction is going to be determined by the slower step. So the slow step is the one that requires more energy. Once that happens, the lower energy one will go quickly. That's not a problem. So this activation energy is going to limit how fast this reaction can occur. Any questions? So let's draw a reaction energy diagram for a one-step reaction that's very fast and very exothermic. So this is the reaction coordinate as time goes on, and this is energy going up. If this is one step, that means we're just going to have one hump in it. If it is a very exothermic reaction, does that mean that the products are higher in energy or lower in energy than the reactants? They'll be lower. If it's very exothermic, then the products will be much lower. Here's P for product and R for reactant. There'll be a large difference in energy here. The energy of the products will be much lower because the difference between these is the amount of energy that's released. A fast reaction means that the hump is going to be small. So we're going to have a hump in here, and it's going to be small. If it was a slow reaction, we'd have a big hump. That would be slow. Any questions? Sometimes, yes. This is... They call it the reaction coordinate. It's kind of like time. Okay. It's like you start over here and the reaction proceeds in this way. Yeah. And it's a method of helping us to visualize something that we can't see. And we're just kind of skimming the surface. And in some ways that's more difficult than if we dive into it and learn all the details. But we don't have time to learn all the details, so we're going to stay with just skimming the surface. So we're not going to do any calculations with this, but we need to understand that reactants higher in energy, products lower in energy, means that that's an exothermic reaction. The opposite would be the products being higher in energy and the reactants lower. That would be endothermic. We have to put energy in to go up the hill. This hump here is the barrier. The activation energy here is just this little bit here. It's between the reactant and the transition state, the top of the hump. If we go back to this guy, this is a transition state. It's not something you can actually isolate. It's just something that happens and then goes into this, and this is an intermediate that actually can be isolated. But the activation energy is between the reactant and the transition state. Now, this is the reactant for the second step, and there's the transition state, so the difference here is much less. But this one we drew over here was just a single step.
did that. So the reaction rate also is a part of Markovnikov's rule. So if we look here at this reaction that we were looking at earlier, propene, and we're adding a hydrogen ion, this is the electrophile, it's attacking, and it could attack either to bond to carbon 1 or carbon 2. What we're going to find is that this carbocation is more stable. Remember, we said that this carbon atom does not like having a positive charge, but this carbon atom has two friends to help it out. This carbon atom has one. More stable means lower in energy. Less stable means higher in energy. And so the activation energy to get to this propyl cation with the charge on carbon 1 is going to be larger. Larger activation energy, slower reaction. This one being more stable is going to have a lower activation energy, so this is going to happen more rapidly. The product that's formed more rapidly is the one that we're going to get more of. Any questions?
That'd be an endothermic reaction?
Yes, this part is endothermic because this intermediate, which is the only product that's shown here, is higher in energy. So yes, that's endothermic.
So you're saying lower in energy means you'll be more stable than higher energy means you'll be less stable?
Yeah. If you think about the piano hanging out the second story window is less stable than a piano that two guys are just holding, right? They're just inches above the ground. Any other questions? What we need to get is just a basic understanding of these ideas. And it takes a little grappling with and working through. But these ideas are going to come back again and again as we learn about different types of reactions. There are other reaction rate factors. Temperature can affect the rate of reaction. Usually if you heat a reaction, it causes the reaction to go faster, but not always. If you're heating the reaction, it means that the particles have more kinetic energy, and so when they collide with greater energy, so more of them are likely to have enough energy to get over the hump. A catalyst is also a way in which you can increase the reaction rate. What a catalyst does is it provides an alternate pathway that has a lower activation energy. No, there's no picture of that. There should be. So I'm going to make a picture of that. Well, I need to actually draw first. So here, if we have this going on here, and we've got maybe this guy, and he's going up here to that guy. Here's our reactant. Here's our product. Okay, this is a high activation energy. There's a big hump here to get over. This is going to be a fairly slow reaction. If we use a catalyst, we can cause this to be lower. One of the ways I think about this in my head is I think about kindergartners out in the field, and for some reason they need to get over a fence. So here we have our little kindergartners. And they need to climb over this fence. And they're little. And it takes them a while to climb up and over the fence. This is the activation energy, getting up and over, right? Well, we can lower the activation energy by taking out one of these rungs. Will the kids be able to get over faster if we take out one of the rungs and lower the fence? Yeah. So now they only have to... Oh, I need something to write with. They only need to get up and over that much. That's going to be a faster reaction. So a catalyst speeds up a reaction by providing an alternate way to get to the product, and that alternate way is going to have a lower activation energy, so it's going to be faster. The catalyst doesn't actually get used up. Another way to think of a catalyst is to, you know, you've got a teacher out here. And the teacher is picking these kids up and lifting them up over the fence. Now the kids don't have to expend as much energy climbing because the teacher's doing it for them. So that's the idea of a catalyst.
Okay.